They feared the Lord, and they spake often one with another. So that's what we're doing here tonight. We welcome those on the live stream. We're glad that you're here with us. We're continuing in the Gospel of John. This will be the 76th exposition of this book. We're going to be in chapter 6, verses 18 through 20. As you know, the people prior to this, the people had seen the miracle of the loaves, is how it's described in this text, and concluded that Jesus was that prophet that should come into the world, which he was. Now, even though this prophecy of the Messiah emphasized that he was going to speak, and emphasized that people should listen and hearken to what he said, these people weren't thinking about what Jesus would tell them. They were telling about what they were going to tell Jesus. That's interesting. They're going to force him to be made king. They conveniently ignored what Jesus said. The prophet's going to speak to you everything I tell him to say. Hearken to him. If you don't hearken unto him, I'll require it of you. Peter said they would be destroyed from among the people. You know, there's a lot of people don't know that. If you don't listen to Jesus, you'll be destroyed from among the people. It's just when. The only issue is when. But I don't think a lot of people even know that about Jesus. Never heard this. Some of the true New Testament churches haven't told the people this. But this is the way it is. But these people knew the Scripture. They weren't like people today. They knew the Scripture. But they purposely sought to advantage their agenda from this. Now, they forgot who they were. They were the people from whom the Messiah would come that would bless all peoples, all nations, all families of the earth. See, that's completely put out of their mind. They were only thinking of their generation. That's the only thing they were thinking about. Now, when a person or a group of persons or a nation is absorbed with self, they make every effort to make God's promises suit what they want. They completely ignore what God has said for the most part and then seek to capitalize. When they talk about the Bible, they're talking about aiding their agenda. They're not talking about the salvation of the soul. Satan, this is so dominant in our time. Trying to make God meet the agenda of the people. Trying to get God to address the social ills. Trying to get God to address the domestic ills. Trying to get God to address the political. It's all off kilter. Yeah. It's so consistent and so large that it can only be accounted for that this is a satanic initiative. This is Satan's initiative. He knows that if he can get people's attention off of Christ and onto this world, he'll keep them out of heaven. He knows that.
Amen.
Yes, people don't know it, but he knows this. So that's what he's doing. National interests, most powerful nation in the history of the world. This is Satan talk. This isn't even God talk. This is what he tried to do in heaven. Now he's trying to do it on earth. See? So these people, this is more serious. That's why Jesus left them. That's it. He departed. They were seeking to associate God with their own agenda. So when you see efforts, and you won't have to wait long to see them, when you see efforts of people to put our attention on affairs that have to do with this world, whether it's personal, domestic, social, political, whatever it is, and that's where the attention is being placed. These people are our enemies. Satan's using these people to divert our attention. If you listen to these people, they'll have you serving their interests.
Yeah. Amen.
I just, this last Tuesday, I commenced a ministry by telephone to a group of people in Ohio. And this was the first installation, so to speak. And they put a loudspeaker on it, and I talked to the audience. And their ministry is helping the homeless and this sort of thing, which is nothing wrong with that, you understand. But we had to deal with a little corrective teaching. I said, now, Jesus, you'll be led to think, and I started my ministry when I was just in my mid-teens. I started ministry working with this kind of people in Pacific Garden Mission. So I'm very well familiar with this kind of work. And I know the tendency is to think if you give them something, if you feed them, clothe them, then you preach to them. I said, is that how you think? He said, yeah, that's what I think. The Lord led me to think that way. I said, no, he didn't lead you to think that way. That's not the right way of thinking. Jesus taught the multitudes, then he fed the multitudes. Check it out and see. Check it out and see. That's what he did. Why is it this way? Because the gospel is the power of God. Your good deeds and philanthropy have no power.
Amen. Amen.
They can't turn people to Christ. We're not saying neglect people. That's not what we're saying. We're saying first things first. If you want God to bless it, you've got to use the power that God's ordained, and which is the gospel. And Jesus lived this out. And the apostles did too.
This crowd, brother, had already spent 3 days with him listening to him.
That's
teach.
Right. Yeah. I know. And they came to hear him.
Yeah.
And many people came to be healed, but they knew he could heal. They didn't come to test it out to see if he could.
They didn't know if
they
was going to eat or not.
That's right. Yes, exactly.
I mean, it
right.
wasn't like we're going to have a meal afterwards.
They didn't know.
On the program.
That's right. Well said. This may seem like a small thing, but when you're involved in ministries like that, it doesn't get away from you, because some people think the best thing you can do in the whole world, the most helpful thing you can do, is to rescue orphans. Now, we're not against that, please. We're not against that at all. But the only difficulty is we don't have an example anywhere in the Bible of anything like that. Now, it doesn't mean God's against it. But it means when it comes to his people as a group, that's not what he's called them to do. Now, our text is John 6, verse 18. Through 20. And the sea arose by reason of a great wind that blew. So when they had rowed about 25 or 30 furlongs, they see Jesus walking on the sea and drawing nigh unto the ship, and they were afraid. But he said unto them, it is I, be not afraid. Then they willingly received him into the ship. And immediately the ship was at the land whither they went. Now this record is recorded in Matthew and Mark also. John says of this occasion, When even was now come, his disciples went down to the sea and entered into a ship and went over the sea and took toward Capernaum. And it was now dark, and Jesus was not come to them. So that's how he sets the stage. In other words, they were doing what Jesus told them to do. Now the title of this lesson is, The Sea Arose While They Were Obeying Jesus. Now Matthew says of this, Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him to the other side while he sent the multitude away. So here then is a circumstance where the disciples were right in the heart of God's will, right? Right in this is going to define trouble for you. Right in the heart of God's will, doing exactly what Jesus told them to do. And this whole scenario that we're going to read about happened then. Now, some people are disposed to think that if you're doing the will of God, it insulates you against trouble. Yeah? And maybe some people, they don't actually say this, but they kind of think in this direction. If I'm serving the Lord, I'm doing what he said to do, I'm obedient, God will make sure nothing difficult comes my way, and I'll not have any trouble. And you could build kind of a theoretic case by networking together some text of scriptures. God is able to chase your enemies away. The angel camp round about you, and there's no weapon formed against you to prosper. See, there's a lot of things, texts you could put together to support this. It sounds really good, but then now we got this live situation here that contradicts the whole thing. See, the most horrendous human experience known to men was found in Jesus Christ, whose visage or appearance was marred more than any of the sons of men. Nobody has ever suffered like Jesus did. And while he was suffering, he was in the process of doing God's will.
Amen.
I tell you, it's something to think about. Paul, he was an unusual sufferer. Paul was. Here is his testimony. He says, in labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more often, in death oft. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A day and a night I've been in the deep, in journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, and watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. All while he was doing the will of God. None of that was chastening. It was all while he was doing the will of God. So see, if you do the will of God, it will not stop very difficult things from happening to you. Imagine a man of God saying, I haven't had clothes. Sometimes I didn't have enough clothing to keep warm. And a day and a night he's bobbing around in the sea somewhere, a day and a night. How would you like to float about in the sea for a day and a night? All while he was doing the will of God. Now this crowd that Jesus left, they're thinking he'll be our king and we won't have any of these troubles then. See, that's just exactly how they were thinking. Yes.
Believe that if you're with Christ, then trials will not come. Then when the trials do come, it will break them.
Yes, right. Well, trials will come.
Right.
Well, you won't face them alone. Yeah. You won't face them alone. You'll outlast the trial. But that's what perseverance. That's where perseverance comes in. And I will tell you, I'm speaking from experience. If you complain, the trial will last longer. Now I've learned this. I know what I'm talking about here. If you chafe, it'll last longer. Just sit out and see if this isn't what happens.
Have a peace about it, it's like you're able to endure, and it seems like it's just for a time.
Yeah, that peace of God is something Satan can't penetrate, so he'll eventually lay off, and God will deliver you. Now, to this point, Matthew says of this occasion, the ship was now in the midst of the sea, and then he adds, tossed with waves. The other, John doesn't mention it, tossed with waves. For the wind was contrary. Mark says that ship was in the midst of the sea, and he, Jesus, was on the land alone. So here's what we know about this circumstance so far. I just want to paint the picture here. Jesus had sent them to the other side of the sea. He sent the multitude away. The disciples were in the process of obeying the Lord. Jesus had stayed behind in a mountain to pray. It was now dark. A great wind had arisen. The wind was contrary to them, or blowing against them, blowing them back to where they disembarked. They were in the middle of the sea, and they were tossed by waves. Well, that's the circumstance. Now, this was a circumstance about which they could do nothing. Not one thing they could do about this, of themselves, do about this circumstance. They couldn't cause a light to shine so they could see through the dark, at least. They couldn't cause that. They couldn't cause the wind to cease blowing. They couldn't command the wind to blow the other way and blow them to the other side instead of back the other way. They couldn't do that. And because of their love for the Lord, they couldn't disobey and go back and not do what Jesus said. So there's a lesson to be learned here. And it's a valuable lesson. There are some things you can do something about, and there are some things you can't do anything about. Now, there are some things you can do something about. You can let Paul over a wall in a basket, and he can escape. Timothy can take a little wine for his stomach's sake, right? Paul can say, I appeal to Caesar, for just treatment. The disciples can send to Jerusalem for some advice on the matter of circumcision, which come up. You can elect some men for administrative needs, distributing food to widows if needed. An offering can be taken for the poor saints in Jerusalem, and if you're Chloe, you can write a letter to Paul, tell him what's happening in Corinth. You can expel a fornicator from the church. See, those are things that you can do. And when you can do these things, I mean, don't be like praying about them. Don't be praying for God to do something about them. If you can do something, they'll say, Lord, deliver Paul. If you can let him over a wall, let him over the wall.
Amen.
Do what you can do. But there are some things you can't do anything about. And it's unwise to spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to do something about things like that. It's a waste of time. Now, I'll pass by this with this remark. God will see to it that you experience both of those things. You will, in your life, change things you will be able to do something about by the grace of God. You will also face things you will not be able to do anything about, and you're going to have to rely solely on the Lord doing something. And you'll get educated in both of those both of those things. And as you grow, you'll find yourself reinterpreting what those things are, because you will find that in Christ you are capable of doing more than you think.
Yeah. Amen.
But never so much that God isn't needed. Never that much. Yes?
I was reminded in a couple instances one was in Revelation and one was with three apostles. One was Paul and Paul and Barnabas? That were in jail, or was it?
Yeah.
They had done the Lord's work, and they suffered for it.
Well, yeah.
They were
Yeah.
Joyful for be counted worthy.
Yeah.
For suffering for his sake. So that just turns everything around that they were counted worthy. And in Revelation, it talks about the saints that suffered for his name.
That's right.
And so there's some things you can't do about. You yourself can't do anything about. But this just, I think it really increases your faith and more of a reliance on God, seeing you can't do anything about it. And you say, Lord, help my unbelief. I can't do anything about this.
That's right. That's right.
I'm depending solely upon you because I can't do anything about it.
And when you look at your life as being directed by God versus being happenstance. See, Satan will tempt you to think of your life just as just happenstance. You just, you don't know what's going to, who knows what tomorrow will come tomorrow. And you're just kind of like on an uncontrollable sea. If you think of, you're thinking the wrong way. The Lord directs the feet of the saints. That's stated, he directs the feet of the saints. And sometimes he directs them to walk through valleys. Sometimes he directs them to walk on mountains. Sometimes he directs them to sail across stormy seas. See? Sometimes he directs them to take punishment from their enemies. Sometimes he delivers them from their enemy, but your steps are directed by the Lord.
Amen.
And when you get up in the morning, commit your way to the Lord. That's not going to activate the Lord to do something. It's going to activate you to look for him to do something.
Amen.
See? Our job is to look, get our eyes open, see what the Lord is doing. You'll be able sometimes to, that's the Lord, that's the Lord. Other times, that's the devil, that's the devil. So you'll be able to, until you'll experience both of these. So when they had rowed about 25 or 30 furlongs, 25 or 30 furlongs, a furlong is 220 yards, or 660 feet. A mile is 5,280 feet. Now, I'm doing this to show you how much they've been rowing. 25 furlongs would be 16,500 feet. 30 furlongs would be 19,800 feet. So that would be 3 1/8 to 3 3/4 miles rowing. I say rowing, possibly most of the time in a storm. The Sea of Galilee was 7 miles across the middle. So that matches exactly what the text says. Matthew and Mark both say they were in the middle of the sea, in 3 1/8 to 3 3/4 in the middle of 7 miles. See, so they. Now, there's no word about how long they've been rowing. We don't have any idea. We can kind of calculate, get an intelligent view of it. Mark tells us that Jesus saw them toiling in rowing. They were grunting and sweating. Had this strong wind blowing against them, and they're rowing into that toiling. It's a hard, hard work. He saw them toiling from the mountain. He looked out there in the middle of the sea, toiling and rowing. Now, Mark tells us that he appeared to them about the fourth watch. About the fourth watch of the night. Matthew says, it was in the fourth watch of the night. Now, the fourth watch of the night was from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. is when a little bit of light began to come up. That was it. Now, it's possible they'd been rowing all night because when they got in, it wasn't quite nighttime when they got in the boat. So let's just say they had been rowing from 6 p.m. to 3 a.m., the beginning of the fourth watch. That's 9 hours. That's 9 hours. I don't know when this storm started. I imagine it started after they got a little way from shore, but my point is, sometimes it takes a lot to obey Jesus. Sometimes you've got to spend a horrendous effort just to do what you're supposed to. We're not talking about going the second mile here. We're just talking about just the beginning. There was no obvious way they could seek the aid of the Lord. They couldn't call out. Here they are. They're not, absolutely nothing but just row. If you don't row, we'll go backward. We'll lose ground if we don't row. We've got to row if they toiled in rowing. So this is an example of perseverance. Now see, this is perseverance lived out. Patience lived out. Perseverance doesn't mean you just continue for a long time. That's not what perseverance means. Perseverance means you continue for a long time under stress and in opposition and in things against you. You keep on even though there's influences that are saying stop. That's what perseverance is. See. Perseverance doesn't, well, I was a Christian 55 years. You know, it's not it. Perseverance is there's all kind of stuff. Your devotion to God has awakened the adversary. And he's going to do as much as God will let him do, which sometimes is a lot. Job can tell you, hey, let me tell you, brethren, we could have Job come here. He said, let me tell you, brethren, sometimes God will allow you to go through a lot that you wouldn't even have gone through if he didn't say you could. Huh? He'd tell you. So this is an example of perseverance. Now here's some things that we have to persevere unto this sort of time. Now, they had to persevere until they got to the other side. That was what was important. Now here's something Jesus told us to do. That's what he told them to do. Go to the other side. They took it seriously. They encountered some obstacle along the way. They toiled and rowed to get to the other side. Jesus has said, what I say to you, I say unto all, watch. All right. There's going to be things that try and take your attention away from watching. Watch. There'll come a time you may have to toil and ruin to watch. We have to spend a lot of effort. Again, he put it this way, watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh at even, or at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. Well, what do you suppose will happen? What do you suppose will happen when Jesus comes and finds someone sleeping? Well, there's five virgins in the scripture that can tell you. You don't get in. That's what it is. Perseverance is, I'm not going to fall asleep. See, in nature, you need sleep. But in the spirit, your spirit doesn't need sleep. You see that? The new creation doesn't need sleep. Sleep is lethal to the new creation. It's necessary to the old creation. Now they're toiling and rowing, but they're alert. Hey, they're alert. They're rowing. When you're rowing to the other side, you're facing you're facing the shore that you disembarked from. See, and your back is facing toward where you're going. So they see Jesus. Now, if they were looking the other way, they'd never seen him. See, but they see Jesus. About the third watch, see the light, a little bit of light. Third watch, beginning of the morning, see a little bit of light begins to show, and they see, hey. They see Jesus. Now John tells you they see Jesus. They didn't know that's who they were seeing, but they saw Jesus. And he was advancing toward them. He's coming toward them, person walking. Matthew, they see Jesus. Matthew says that the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. So with all this going on, Nate, and you see, some people would never have. You spend some time with Jesus, it makes you alert. It actually makes you alert to see things. And his disciples saw him walking on the sea. Matthew says, he saw his disciples saw him walking on the sea, and they were troubled, saying, it's a spirit. And cried out for fear. Mark records the same action. Now notice, these disciples had some understanding about the spirit world. This is not what someone from the United States would say. They thought they saw a spirit. And I gather it wasn't an amiable spirit they were thinking about, one that coming to bless. They thought they were seeing a spirit walking on the water. Now, I don't know, there's no example of that in Scripture, but they couldn't think of anything else. What else could this be? And they were afraid. Yes.
A comment from Brother Robert via live stream. That when Jesus sends you to the other side of the sea, there's not any storm that can stop you.
That's right. Amen.
Amen.
Now, Matthew tells us that this is the time when Peter walked on the water. John doesn't record that for us, but Matthew does. Peter, Jesus cried out, "It's me, don't be afraid." And Peter answered and said, "Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee in the water." This is during a storm. This is not nice, cool, placid water. This is during a storm, waves. "Bid me to come, if it's really you, bid me to come unto thee." Now, what kind of man, does that sound like a wishy-washy man to you? Peter's, you know, he's pictures man stuck his foot in his mouth and hasty to speak and everything. Does this sound like a hasty kind of speaker? Is this the kind of thing someone who's weak would ask? Known for weakness would ask. "Bid me come on the water." So Jesus, he just says one word. "Come." But there was power in that word. Power in that word. So Peter, he immediately, he climbs down out of the ship, which tells you it was a, we know there are at least 12 people in it. So it was a pretty good sized boat. He climbed down out of the ship and commenced walking on the water to go to Jesus. Now, beside Jesus, Peter's the only man in history that has ever walked on water. Nobody else has ever walked on water.
Amen.
He walked on the water. So those that criticize Peter, I would challenge them to walk on the water. Just a little way.
Right.
Just walk maybe a yard or so. Just a little way. Just stand on the water. Well, I'll settle for that. And then when you admit you can't do it, then explain to me why Peter was able, the guy you've been criticizing, tell me how he was able to do it.
Amen.
He walked on the water to go to Jesus. However, his attention was diverted to the storm. And as soon as it was, he sank. Well, how long does it take to sink in water? I mean, I'd give a little test to see. Give it a little test. How long can you stand on top of the water? When you start sinking, how long does it take to sink? And with waves. But before he went under, he said, "Lord, save me." Huh? Before his head is underwater, he said that, and Jesus caught him, lifted him up. He didn't say, "Good job, Peter. Boy, you did something the other disciples didn't do. Oh, I thank God for you, Peter, because you had that kind of faith to walk that far. At least you made some headway." That's not what he said. This is the real Jesus. We're being introduced to the real Jesus here. He said to him, "Oh, thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" So he's holding him by the hand. That's what he said to him. Now I will tell you that if you think back in your life of times when you were distressed about this or that, and then the thing was resolved, if you had ears to hear, Jesus told you. Why did you doubt? I could, I think I probably have told you this before. When you get older, you tell stories over and over and you don't realize you did, but when I was hired at Lever Brothers, I had worked previously at Lever Brothers, but I was 15 years old and I lied about my age, forged my birth certificate, and worked there with one of my friends, and the friend lost his hand in an industrial accident. And when he did, they found out about us. To this day, the litigation hasn't been totally solved for that young man. Now, when I went out seeking work, it was a recession, and this was the only place I hadn't gone to get a job, was Lever Brothers. And I told the Lord, I said, I can't lie, but they're going to ask if I've worked here before. So I'm asking you, Lord, don't let them ask this, because I got three kids and I don't have work and I got to have a job. And so I gave all the presentations. So I did, I came there. But it got a long story short. They didn't ask me if I would work there before. And I was hired. 10 years passed. And after 10 years, I was an accountant, a cost accountant at that time. The head of the accounting department called me in and said, "You worked here before, didn't you, Gavin?" I thought, "This is it." "Yeah." I said, "I did." He said, "We knew it all along." Said, "You know Joe Dula?" "Oh, yeah." So I went to school with Joe Dula. He said, "He worked here. He works here. And he told us you'd been born again." We didn't have any idea what that meant. But Joe told us you're a dependable man now. We hired you on his strength 10 years ago. I walked out of that room and I thought, I spent 10 years worrying for nothing. That was Jesus saying, "Amen. Oh, you of little faith, wherefore did you doubt? Did you think I was going to abandon you?" See? Anyway, it's a lesson to be learned there. That's the real Jesus. How do you answer a question like that? Why did you doubt? Yes, Brother Aaron.
A child of any sort has the ability to make us self-concerned.
Oh, yeah.
Or has the ability to make us or help us to deny ourselves. And I think there's other things like that too.
Amen.
A double-edged sword. So in Esau's case, he got selfish when he thought he was in danger.
Yeah.
And despised his birthright. But then when David was in danger, that resulted in a lot of the Psalms that he wrote. So one man was pushed down towards the earth, and one man was drawn up towards heaven, both by similar circumstances.
Amen.
Everyone, Job said, is guaranteed that they're going to have trouble in life.
Yes, right.
As sparks fly upward.
Amen.
So it's not a matter of if, it's just a matter of when. And another thing about trial is that we don't always have an explanation of why it came. And if we were given it, we might not be able to handle the explanation.
That's right.
Job kind of complained about, you know, trying to figure out why all these things came, and I don't think the Lord ever told him.
No.
We know because of the revelation that's given. But God's answer to Job really didn't answer the question.
That's right.
That's right.
Yes, that's something what I was alluding to when I said that God will see to it you learn these lessons. That there are things that even an educated man can't resolve. And there are things that the simplest of men can resolve. See, but you've got to tell the difference, and you can't let your trial build a wall. See, there's something about unbelief. Unbelief is noisy. So if unbelief enters in, you aren't able to hear this still small voice saying, this is the way, go ye in it. You won't be able to hear it, see? But if you keep, if you believe, then that won't happen. Now there's a song written by William Bradhurst in the 1800s about this, and I want to read the words to you. We've sung it here, but it's a song of a person who's learned this lesson about life having trials. Oh, for a faith that will not shrink though pressed by many a foe, that will not tremble on the brink of any earthly woe, that will not murmur nor complain beneath the chastening rod, but in the hour of grief and pain will lean upon its God. A faith that shines more bright and clear when tempests rage without, that when in danger knows no fear and darkness feels no doubt, that bears unmoved the world's dread frown nor heeds its scornful smile, the seas of trouble cannot drown, not Satan's arts beguile. Oh, that is rich, I'll tell you. So Peter was brought up on the surface. He said he identified, it is I. He didn't say it's Jesus. This is Jesus. This is Jesus. He said, it is I. See, they recognized that voice. They'd recognize that voice. They knew who that was. Matthew reports a little fuller report. He says, Jesus said, be of good cheer, it is I. Be not afraid. See, so when Jesus turns up, that's a time to be glad.
Amen.
Well, that's a time to be glad. That's a time to be cheerful. So haven't you noticed this as you gather with the saints, or whether maybe you're by yourself or maybe you're with a cluster of brethren someplace, and you can kind of tell that Jesus has showed up? And all of a sudden, there's a gladness that be of good cheer. You want to live close enough to the Lord Jesus that you can hear him when he says, this is me. You thought it was a circumstance. This is me. I'm coming to you. On this trouble, I'm coming to you. Huh? On this stormy wave, I'm coming to you. On this thing that's made you toil and ruin, on that I'm coming to you. See, be of good cheer. One dreadful effect of living at a distance from Christ or outside the perimeter of obedience, when you live out there on the edge, you'll not be able to hear. Jesus say, be of good cheer, it's I. You won't be able to hear it. Now the text says they willingly received him into the ship. See, now they weren't about to do this to a spirit, you know. They willingly received him into the spirit. The New American Standard says they were willing, therefore, since he said it's me, they're willing, therefore, to receive him into the boat. Then they wanted to take him into the boat, the New Revised Standard Version says. They were glad to take him into the boat, the Revised Standard says, when they were quite willing and glad for him to come into the boat. Well, I guess so. Well, that's the way I felt too. When I knew it was Christ, I was glad for him to come in too. Matthew points out that Peter was with Jesus when he entered the ship. I assume they walked together on the water while the storm was raging. Matthew says, and when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. So they had to walk. Peter had to walk on those waves. The whole way back. He had to walk on those waves with Jesus.
Obviously he wasn't doubting then.
No, he sure wasn't. And he wasn't looking at the storm either, was he?
Amen.
Now Mark reports that Jesus himself entered into the ship. He went up unto them in the ship and the wind ceased. So it was his presence that caused the winds to stop. It's still his presence that causes the winds of trial to stop. See, the wind didn't cease when Jesus lifted Peter up to the surface. See, the wind, it didn't cease then. It must have been some experience. Got your bearing now. Get a good grip standing there. Peter had to walk back by faith. Right? He had to walk back by faith, just like he started out.
Amen.
By faith. And he, as we pointed out, he surely didn't look at the storm. You know, his eyes were fastened on the Lord Jesus all the way back. Sometimes the way out of trial is just as stormy as the trial itself. He walked through the storm. It says when he got in the boat. I don't know how far it was out there. I have no idea, but I have an idea it wasn't like a yard. Sometimes the way out is stormy. Now the text says they were sore amazed. They were sore amazed at themselves beyond measure and wondered. Oh, boy. Now this is the second time Jesus has stilled a storm for them. The first is when they were going to the country of the Gadarenes. Remember that? And the storm came up and he was asleep in the boat. Remember? And he got up, stilled the storm. And they were amazed. What manner of man is this? They were amazed again. But at this time, somehow they weren't able to correlate those two. They weren't able to think, wait a minute, we were in a storm before and Jesus stilled the storm. So of course we got this blessing again. Instead, they were amazed again. See, amazed again. Now, Mark tells us why they were amazed, and you would never, this is not what you would think. Why were they amazed? For they considered not the miracle of the loaves. And therefore their heart was hardened. That's Mark tells you. You would have thought they didn't consider the other time. You'd think that's what he'd say. They didn't consider the other time. No. He said they didn't consider the miracle of the loaves, which had just happened the day before. Other versions say they had not understood about the loaves because their heart was hardened. New American Standard says they had not gained any insight from the incident of the loaves, but their heart was hardened. How is it that a miracle of the loaves could make a person think right in a storm? Well, because of the miracle of the loaves, Jesus demonstrated to you that he can do anything. He can meet any crisis. He has no trouble resolving a problem. See, all that was demonstrated, but they couldn't make the transition between the miracle of the loaves and their trouble. Yes.
I remember a few weeks ago you told us that we should not be amazed when Jesus performs miracles because our faith is deep enough to recognize it's just what he does. And clearly in this case the disciples on the boat didn't have that deep faith at that moment.
That's right. Yes, yeah, so it's intriguing to think about because it helps you to assess your own life. That I want to be careful how I say this, but you don't want to assume you believe. You examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. You prove your own selves. So you don't want to assume you believe. Some people, concerning the background I came from, some people assume because they were baptized, they're still believing, which may not be the case at all. They may actually have departed from the faith. Simon was baptized, that sorcerer from Samaria. He believed and was baptized. But by the time Peter and John got there, they sure didn't look too good. So don't assume you believe. And if you have doubts about it, say, help my unbelief. See, there's you don't have to be weak in faith. Yes, Sister Ada.
One of the things linked to that the multiplying of the loaves was that Jesus had looked on the crowd and was filled with compassion.
Yeah, that's good.
Because they were like sheep without a shepherd.
Yeah.
So that would be some of the understanding too to come. That here they watched their Lord look upon the people. He would not send them away without showing them mercy.
Amen.
And that was the same Lord that came to them on the cross.
Amen. Amen. He'll not leave that situation, leave them in that situation. Yes.
It occurred to me, I know we've left that part of it, but you know, Jesus walked through the storm too.
That's right.
I mean, he walked through that wind pushing against him as he walked. That's not very comfortable. And the water and all of the...
He was in the body.
Yeah. Right. So, I mean, he didn't have to do that, but he did it in order to get to them, and it didn't ease up until he got in the boat with them. So he purposely... shared in that, however you want to.
And as he's walking, he didn't appear as though he was going to stop off.
Yeah.
He looked like he wasn't going to turn aside. And that's something.
Yeah.
Now, whenever God works in any way, we do well to consider that work. It will help to reshape our thinking. If it's been off kilter, it'll help to reshape it. For instance, when Ananias and Sapphira died because of their lie, it says, great fear came upon all the church. All the church. And the church wasn't corrupt. Huh? The two corrupt people that had been purged, great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard these things. See, they considered that miracle. And then some other people, considering the miracle, it says, of the rest durst no man join himself to them. we're not going to go in there. We're not going to become identified to that church, because we can see the God that visits that church, the Christ that's in that church, won't put up with hypocrisy. You'll never hear anything like that today. At least I don't think so. The church has been so neutralized that people don't even associate the church with holiness. Not even associated with it. I'm talking about as a rule. And others, you know, they heard about Christ's healing and they brought their sick by droves. They believed what they heard about Jesus. They knew Jesus did something. They didn't come to experiment. If you've ever attended some of these healing meetings, and I have, if there are any healings, they're very rare. Very rare. At the healing meetings I'm talking about, very rare. Matter of fact, tonight I took a group of brethren to hear Oral Roberts, because I wanted them to have exposure to him. We come in the auditorium, Morris Civic Auditorium in Chicago. A sign up at the top said, wheelchairs this way. When we left over the exit, there was a sign that said, wheelchairs this way. One of the brethren said, well, that tells the story. But that is not the kind of thing that happened where Jesus was. This did not happen. Quite frequently, he healed them all. But my point here was, they heard Jesus was healing, and they brought their sick in droves. And then when the church was launched, they heard healing was still going on, and the cities brought them to Peter. Because they heard a testimony of something genuine that was happening. See, and if the people of God... we'll get self out of the way and let God work according to his will. We're not telling how the manner of God will work. But if it's discernible to some extent, it's discernible that God's working, it'll get the attention of people that are seeking the Lord. Now, we've experienced this here. We know about this. I myself know about this. I realized where I found where Jesus was at, and I wanted to be there. Yes.
Part of the reason that we want to consider the work that the Lord has performed is in order to be able
equate his work with his ways.
That's good.
I remember the children of Israel and Moses, they were given that distinction that the children of Israel saw his works, but Moses knew his ways.
His ways, amen.
So yeah. When the Lord works, we want to examine that. We want to meditate upon those things so that we can connect those two and learn more about him through that work.
Amen.
Amen.
That's a great truth, great insight. Now, when he got in the ship, remember, they were in the middle. They were at least 3 miles, a little over, from shore. Immediately, the ship was at the land. After rowing most of the night and only getting halfway, you know, immediately, they were at the land whither they went. It's as though the circumstance yielded to Jesus. See? But the disciples yielded to the circumstance. See the, see the difference? Jesus was the one in charge. He was the one in charge. You can make gigantic leaps in the faith, you know, just a moment of time. Well, just think what happened to Paul on the road to Damascus. What happened in that brief time? I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. Why? He makes this gigantic quantum leap. What do you want me to do, Lord? See? So you don't have to wait to make a lot of progress in Christ. All you have to do is discern where he's, where he is. This is why it's wrong. It's not advisable to attend a dead environment. Because Jesus, death repels Jesus. It does. And nothing much is apt to happen there unless just your faith takes hold of something. But if you can be someplace where Christ is, you can make great strides in the faith in a relatively short period of time. Now, some of us were in Christ for several years. And we were almost like static. We every once in a while you gain a little something, but it was. But all of a sudden, whew, you're trafficking with the apostles, and what they saw, you're seeing. What happened? You got where Jesus was, or if you want to get technical, Jesus got where you were. Where you were, but you can make great strides in the faith in a relatively short period of time. But if you limit yourself, your religion is wrapped up in routines and procedures and rules, and it's wrapped up in that, you'll just have to learn to live in a storm all the time. Now, here's what Paul said about that, about a religion that consists of ordinances and rules and regulations and ordering the body and so forth. He says, such regulations indeed have appearance of wisdom. I fast so many times a day, and I read 3 chapters of Psalms and 3 chapters of Proverbs. I go on a prayer walk, and you got all this stuff you say that sounds very impressive. With their self-imposed worship, that is, you're not doing something God told you to do. Their false humility and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value. Those routines, they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. They can't stop you from being tempted. They can't take away the appeal of sin. Can't do it. There are people trying to do this all the time. That's toiling and rowing and getting nowhere. That's what it is. Empty religious routine robs the soul and puts the heart and mind to sleep. Particularly, I'll just speak from my own experience. You're in like a sterile spiritual environment. Pretty soon you get kind of used to it. It doesn't chafe you as much as it once did. And as a result, you don't extend yourself as much as you would otherwise. Otherwise, you would extend yourself more. It's a kind of sterile religion is a kind of soil in which unbelief and doubt will flourish. You'll be tempted with unbelief. In that kind of environment, this will happen. Because, from to begin with, you will appear stronger than you really are. Because you'll be surrounded by a bunch of, you'll be an eaglet surrounded by a bunch of little chicks. Yeah, you. But see, the, I understand there had been experiments along that raised an eagle with a bunch of turkeys. And the eagle couldn't fly. Took a special man to work this eagle up so it could fly. Because it, he dwelt among turkeys all the time, and that's what he, you know, with a turkey or a chicken, if you can fly up to the top of a 6-foot pole, that's monumental, you know, that's high flying. There are some people like this, brethren. Well, maybe most of us were one of these people at one time. We were so used to being around people that hardly knew anything that it made us appear as though we really, really had something. And we did, but it wasn't nearly as big as we thought it was. See? So when you get with Jesus and he gets in the boat with you, it's a lot of things happen. Storm ceases, and you get where you're going quicker. And you're sure a lot happier. And all those righteous deeds that men try and do of their own, the prophet says in Isaiah 64, I believe it is, says all of our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. So, time with Jesus, that's, you know, when you're baptized into Christ, right? We're children of God by faith. When you're in Christ and Christ is in you, that condition is what makes the difference. It's not what you did in your obedience. That's not what made the difference. Back behind that, particularly your baptism, was the operation of God. That's what made the difference, see? And the more you're in an environment that cultures your soul, the more aware you become of that. That you owe your progress you owe to the Lord. He's the one that's brought you this far. As a matter of fact, from the mountain, Jesus actually kept these men from dying out there. He was sustaining them so they could keep on rowing. They didn't realize it, but he did it. All right, I think I'll close there. Any of you have a word you'd like to add? Yes, Brother Jonathan?
Yes, that calling out, save me, Lord. Yeah, that storm clearly was not a problem for Jesus.
That's right.
But Peter knew that.
Yes.
He knew that wasn't too much. That's why he could call.
That's right.
Even when they came the first time, they said, like, carest thou not that we perish? To me, that kind of hints that they knew he could do something about it. That was what my mind says. Like, you can do something and you're not doing it versus we're all going to die, Lord.
Yeah.
But, yeah, just having that awareness, like, this isn't affecting him. He's not, like, sinking in this. That's, like, that'll enable you to call out to him every time because you know.
Amen.
As long as he's there, he can keep you standing because he himself will never be overcome by himself.
And he will not turn aside whoever calls it. Whoever calls in the name of the Lord shall be saved, right? And there's an example of it. I really encourage you in this area because I know you can live in our society. It's ups and downs and ins and outs and erratic stuff happening all the time. And who knows what the day will bring forth. In this kind of a time, you can get to the point where you forget. You forget this, that if you call in the name of the Lord, he won't turn a deaf ear. He will not do it. And I thank God for it. Yes, Brother Jim.
If we're able to read this kind of after the fact, it's painfully obvious that the whole situation took place to accomplish something in the disciples. That's the only reason. It wasn't just there was a storm, and in the midst of the storm, something good happened. Because after that good was accomplished, immediately they were where they were going.
Amen.
So that's kind of a refreshing take on life. Whenever there is a storm, there just didn't happen to be a storm that
Amen.
I had to go through. It is specifically for my preparation.
That's a wonderful insight. And it's sometimes that's about all you know, right there. The path of steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Yes, to Maddie.
I appreciate the immediacy with which Jesus responded to Peter's request.
Yeah.
It makes a point to say that Jesus immediately reached out and got a hold of Peter's hand. He didn't have to dive under the waves to rescue him.
And
so when we cry out for help to the Lord, we can have confidence that he will not get there too late.
Yeah.
I also have another comment from Brother Robert. He said, walking through a storm on the water is worth all the trouble if you are with Jesus.
Amen.
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 I think there's a little parallel with what the scripture says here. It says, then they willingly received him into the ship.
Yes.
You know, I willingly received Christ into my heart and my troubles are gone. I'm getting to where I want to go, or where the Lord is leading me. So.
There's a lot there, isn't there? Yeah. That was in a storm, they will. The storm was raging when he stepped in the boat. It was still raging.
As it is with us. Generally,
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes, as Mark's account, he says, and would have passed by them. There's a sense which Jesus was coming to them on the water. But there, in another sense, he was just making himself accessible to them.
That's right. That's right.
You see what I'm saying? And they actually had to avail themselves of Jesus.
I think if you trace that through Scripture, Brother Tony, you'll find that the Lord making himself accessible, that there's a lot of that. Maybe like in the burning bush or on the road to Damascus. There's a number of incidents where he made himself accessible and where there was appropriate response. He got in the boat.
He does make a note of this, when the Lord called Samuel. And does make a note that he did not know the Lord, but the Lord still made himself accessible. And then when Eli knew that it was the Lord, he told Samuel what to say. And so
that's right.
The Lord made himself available to Samuel. And once Samuel knew who it was, then he said that it was
got the message, didn't he? Yeah, he knew who Eli was. See, God positions. God knew all along he's going to give Samuel a message. But he saw to it that he was in Eli's, because Eli's sons, he wasn't pleased with his sons either, you know. He didn't do well with his sons, but he knew the Lord. He knew when God was addressing. So it took him 3 times, but he finally. There's where Samuel persevered, didn't he? Kept on coming. So if you don't understand, keep on coming back. Keep on asking. Yes, Brother Aaron.
In a sense, the whole world is a sea that's raging. And when we have peace, that is the exception.
Amen.
It's like the world is a sieve or a sift that the Lord is using to perfect men for eternity. And I think it's an incredible disadvantage for people to view life in general in opposite of that, as if trouble is the exception and peace and comfort is the rule.
Now you take Revelation says that the woman, which was God's people, the earth help the woman. Now Satan is not trying to destroy the United States or trying to destroy sinners. They're already in his power. But he's trying to destroy the saints. But the world's absorbing the biggest part of it. The biggest part of his effort is absorbed by the world. The earth's helped the woman. All that would have fallen on God's people. All those tornadoes, all those hurricanes, all those wars, all that stuff would have fallen on God's people. But they're in the middle of a world and they absorb the shock. It doesn't make us glad. Well, we're glad that God is considering us. But God is operating with his people in mind. That's what's on his mind. So when you see someone suffer and you, if this isn't true all the time, but sometimes you can say, yeah, that could have fallen, that could have very well fallen on me. There before the grace of God go I, someone said. Yes. All right.